So hi guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive, and we are standing here with Bleed From Within's finest, Goonzi. Mate, what a set that just was. How did that feel?
Yeah, mate, it was unbelievable. Just weird being back at a festival, and like the first show back in 18 months was like the biggest show we've ever played, I think. So that was, it was weird, but it felt great, man.
That's it.
It was a beautiful mess.
Well, you sucked everybody in, because obviously, you know, people are here, they're here to have a good time. The moshing, the circle pits, people are a little bit hesitant, then you suck them in and then you put the fire on.
Yeah. We had that up our sleeve, man. We've been wanting to do that for a while, and this felt like the right time.
Yeah, absolutely.
The first show back, so we went for it, man.
So you had the Carillion up there that you're playing, yeah. Now, tell us a bit about this brand, because it's not one that I'm massively familiar with. How did you end up working with these guys?
It's a guy called Chris. He hand builds everything himself. He just got in contact with me, and he was like, I love your stuff. And I already knew about them, already followed them on Instagram and stuff. And I was like, man, I fucking love your guitars. And he's like, let's build some guitars. So we just got chatting and talked about, like, everything's custom. So he just talked about what I liked and what I wanted, and advised some stuff and what kind of woods to use and stuff. So ended up with three absolute beautiful guitars, man. I absolutely love them. So.
Absolutely. And what are some of your key factors there when it was coming to customising these guitars? You know, obviously it looks like it's a pretty thin neck on there, big frets.
Yeah, but I specifically requested a thin neck because I was playing Ibanez's before, which are like super thin, so I was like, can the neck be really thin? But I need one with a Floyd Rose in it.
Right.
Like, even though I hate how heavy they are and how thick the body has to be, but I need it for all the kind of whammy stuff that I do. So the first one was the Floyd Rose, the white one. And then second one was the Pale Moon Ebony fretboard one, the second guitar I used to
Do. Yeah.
That's like super light, that weighs nothing. So like I changed to that because it's like air.
Yeah.
So it just weighs nothing.
Absolutely.
It feels so good. So
are they all loaded with the bare knuckles?
Yes. The white one has juggernauts, I think, and the other two have Ragnaroks.
Yeah. And what about amp-wise? Because I know that you toy around with a few different bits and pieces. You've also been, you know, one of the earliest adopters to the Neural DSP stuff.
Yeah.
What were you using today?
It was the Neural DSP Quad Cortex.
Killer.
The new bit of hardware, man. So that was the first show we used that, man.
So what's the feedback then on that? I mean, it sounded great from my end, but what about when you're up there?
I only have in-ear monitors. We don't have amps or cabs on stage then, so it sounds fucking great in my ears, man. So that's all I care about, but it sounds great, man.
Like, absolutely.
We were using the Kemper before.
Yeah.
We had that as a backup just in case, but it sounded great, man. Like,
awesome.
We've got all the MIDI patch switching going
with
the click, so we don't have to like touch anything on the pedal board. Everything worked smoothly today, everything changed perfectly, so I'm very happy with the result. It sounds incredible though.
Well, anytime you see you guys live, it's obviously not only fantastic music, but it's a technical mastery as well. You know, you guys, you never drop the ball. What's your sort of top tips for keeping your chops in shape?
Just practice, man. I mean, it was weird being back playing a show like that, because it's so different to when you're rehearsing.
Yeah.
You can practice, but then when you're standing in front of an audience, you've got adrenaline, you want to play faster.
Yeah.
So you need to slow yourself down and relax. I mean, it would be doing better if we'd been playing shows constantly up until now. We'd be a lot tighter, I think, and I'd feel a lot more comfortable. So it was weird getting back into it. But by the end of the set, it was like, just you're warmed up and you're used to the adrenaline and you're playing a bit slower because everything feels half speed. You're like, this song is so slow.
Yeah.
But it's not. It's just your adrenaline, so you need to kind of get yourself used to that.
Obviously, you know, Fracture was just, well, it was just a minute ago, really, but, you know, it feels like a long time with everything that's been going down.
Yep.
Obviously, that came out right in the midst of lockdown and shutdowns and pandemics and what have you. Was there ever any hesitation about putting it out during that period?
Definitely, man. It's something we spoke about, like, should we, because a lot of the other bands were, like, putting back their releases and stuff, but we decided to just, we wanted to keep up the momentum basically from Era, because before that we hadn't released an album and it was like 5 year gap, so like, we can't do that again, man, so we'll just release it and just see what happens. We kind of hoped the shows would have been back last summer, but
we didn't know at that point that it was going to be as long,
but
you know,
we managed to do the live stream instead,
of course,
so
at least
we got something out of that. But by the time the headline tour comes around this November, we'll be almost finished the new album.
Wow.
Which is wild, so.
Okay. But can you give us any news on that at the moment? Is there a name or?
Not yet. It's very early days. We're maybe about 9-10 songs in, but it's been recorded this year at some point.
Fantastic. Well, I mean, that's the thing that's a shame, because Fracture, what a record, and it's not that it flies under the radar, it's done fantastic and the feedback is great, but sometimes you feel when a band doesn't get to tour it, it's like, did it really happen, sort of thing, you know what I mean? Wrong. So I would imagine that part of this tour, Fracture is going to be play a big part.
Oh yeah. It's still the Fracture tour,
yeah.
Even though it's like a year and a half delayed, but it's still based around that album. We may play a new song if it's ready by the time November rolls around, but we'll see. But yeah, it definitely sucked not having any shows after releasing an album, but today made up for it, man. That was sick.
So, just as a fan of heavy music, you know, what does this mean to you to be at Download, especially? I mean, it's a pretty historic event, isn't it? You know, got to be the first live shows in Europe.
Yeah,
So just imagine you're a punter here. Yeah. Like, what would be your takeaway?
I just can't believe that it's the first thing is Download Festival, because we all have been going to Download Festival since we were like kids. So like, we've been growing up on coming here. I think it was like maybe almost 10 years ago maybe we've been coming to this festival, maybe more. But to be here playing as well, it's like I would have loved to have come to this just as a punter.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to be a punter for the rest of the day, man. I'm going to be watching every band. But yeah, it's definitely emotional, man.
Yeah.
And I don't have any emotions. I feel no emotion, but I'm definitely getting emotional today, man.
well, mate, it was a pleasure chatting with you. Cheers, you go mate. And enjoy the rest of the festival, and we'll see you on tour.
Cheers, mate.
Thanks, mate.
See you there.